talk about today is, with our panel, is really the issue of taxpayers broadly, but we're also going to get into some institutional models that have been implemented to great effect. So, one, guide students in the appropriate pathways, but also ensure success in whatever gateway courses that they're taking, to include algebra, because we all know that, of course, there's still students, particularly when we're talking about STEM programs, and you heard it from many of the folks on our GPS STEM project yesterday, getting students to algebra still is an important issue. But the point is, how do we get all students through gateway courses and using theoretical strategies to do that? So first of all, I want to turn to Amy Deck. We're super excited to be working with Amy and the Data Center and Ernie and Jenna Cohen on a strategy working with 6 states as well as the Houston area. So we're working with Indiana, Colorado, Nevada, Ohio, Montana, and Missouri, as well as the Houston area, on how they can build that complete system of pathways, all the way from making a clear statement about the importance of pathways to college success, all the way to designing the appropriate courses, and ultimately get to the end of the program of study. So, Amy, you work with math faculty all the time, and you know, there's this question of whether pathways make sense. And talk to us about some of the momentum that's building and the work that's happening in terms of math pathways, and maybe give us a little bit more background on what you mean by math pathways.
I really appreciated when Mary was up here that when she said to make all the differentiation between just talking about the prerequisite structure and thinking about math pathways in a more global and systemic way. Because that's certainly what we advocate for at the Data Center to work with the Mathways project within the MP. So what we have done is we've identified what we consider to be sort of four essential principles for the math pathway. And this is all within the context of thinking about that a math pathway, as it's promising, shouldn't just be about developmental courses or gateway courses or that kind of courses. It should be about a pathway that gets students to two and three college level courses and to their program of study. And the four principles that we think are really important to have considered in setting up a math pathway. First of all, that there should be content that is relevant to students' program of study and challenging and rigorous. And I'll tell you, that is the key in talking to math faculty. If you talk to them about this is about getting students through math or, you know, trying to make the math easier, it will turn off math faculty. What's important to us as math faculty is that we think that the students getting content that's important to them. And this is where we're seeing a huge change in attitudes from math educators all over the country. And our leadership from the professional associations of mathematics have really stepped forward, and they're coming out with a lot of reports and statements right now saying we should be giving students the opportunity to take mathematics that goes beyond the college algebra traditional pathway. We also really strongly in acceleration, that's the second principle of the MMP. Intentional use of student success strategies. Mary talked about how courses should be built to support students as well. And curriculum pedagogy and that are based on evidence. And Mary kind of referred to that. But there's a whole suite of things that need to be considered as when you're implementing that pathway.
So tell me a little bit about, I mean, you have been working intensely initially with Georgia and Ohio in terms of getting and building the momentum in the state of my main campus. Talk a little bit about that process and how you got into the point where they actually made a very public statement about the needs in that campus.
Well, I don't want to be exercised there because after all, we've studied the Texas and that's where we have wanted to proceed to. So in Texas, we started with faculty and with presidents, with the state. I think, again, it's a key issue here is that you can't think of it as just what happens in the classroom or just what happens at the state level. You have to go through the entire system. And by working in the, within the state of Texas, we've been able to do that. We've addressed policy issues and the implementation on the ground. So that we now have 31 out of 50 community college districts in Texas either already implementing that pathways or in an active process. So based on that success, we had the opportunity to work with Georgia and Ohio, in which we helped them set established math classes that brought math-wise faculty together from across the 2 year and 4 year cycle, very early on to improve those. Plus, people with unprepared policy issues, that group formed their own vision of how these concept of math pathways would play out in their school. And it's really important to think about that, what that means, is that even though we've sort of established these broad principles as being the skeleton, each state has individual issues that they need to look at and understand, and the faculty need to have a voice, and they need to take ownership of the vision and the process.
So anyway, it's one of the states that jumped in and developed a math pathway. We heard a lot about what's already happening from Mary a little bit earlier, but Rob, a math faculty member, and provided key leadership in building these pathways. So Rob, tell us a little bit about, of course, let's help us understand the pathways and sort of the things that you went through, and the most important part of how it's connected to your programs, and so you're aligning the right pathway to the right program for students. I want to back it up. I just want to even when it works, it didn't work. Jessica, after wandering through here and really talk with students in every one of those boxes, and then get over here and there's about 8 different things you could try. And that's the one thing I missed. She wandered through this, and after 5 semesters, she's got through it. She came in and told me that she was trying to get into a nursing program. She's got to go to a nursing program. Sunday afternoon, she called and said, "I'm so excited to get out of the hospital for kids." You know, she bummed up all of the support. She bummed up. It all worked out. The next year, in the class, she didn't get any classes at least. But time is the enemy. And the barriers of family, of relationships, of family, and distance, and just the ability to concentrate real quick. So, we started with that, and we went through it. With Dr. Oscar's leadership and also my president, we've come down the three pathways. The first one is the prerequisite model. Basically, the key skills that we need for the one we take currently to go live in 23 and the spring training. That's about 100 programs you need to move. And if you start to put kids in these programs, about 80%, this is up until I'm saying it's 75-80% of our students will end up in the quantitative reasoning process. 15% of our programs, or about 14% of our students, should be recognized. And then, again, the college algebra, the calculus, was the way to learn about 6-7%. And even through a faculty process, we're encouraging them to use across the state. And every program faculty can have the opportunity to say, this is the math my program needs. And so if we make backwards from that, we move several programs out of the college algebra, which back up into quantitative reasoning. The tech math course is applied math. It's only for 9 months. I'm not sure that's associated with that. It's almost 2 years of teaching certificates. It's got to be going to the teacher with all the hands-on in the spring, the pass rate, as Mary already said, is up to the 50% for the pilots and the quantitative reasoning. Intern grade for 748 students in textbook math, 52 sessions across 14 units of the title. 83% were passing. Pathways before, like Sam said, we had undecided courses in the demo studies, and now you're either in the same class with someone who specifically needs that, you're in applied science area, or you're going to take the second class, and the default from the math is the degree. So if we get it to the previous slide, the same thing from a data institution on that, so the default is really the quantitative reasons we have, and let's just be very clear about what that is. I would believe that first thing is true, that there's no need to make up the lines in which you first place. This sort of flips what we traditionally say, which is a higher value for us, that is very fun for many of our students. So just a lot of clear, since you're at the University of Nevada Reno, you work at a four-year institution, and so it's a little bit of a different situation. And you do have, sort of pathways, but you had a problem with interviewing the algebra, creating a bottom line. And started a conversation with my faculty at least on this campus about really why that was and what you could do about it to actually increase the success of students in both classes, both algebra as well as math and other classes. So talk about what you do.
Okay, so you have a four-year institution in the back of my world. Our nursing program requires some sort of on-site courses, just like the science and engineering course. So we've got a lot of people taking college algebra. And again, intermediate algebra had about 50%. The students coming out of that about 50% success rate in college algebra. And at the same time, that is something more than just this, but clearly, just raising the level of rigor and looking at the class with a college more together. Instead, it takes one credit of the media material along with students cover the entire term, they're actually doing quite well in one or another course. So that one of the tools that I still have is for them is the power of statistics from one, but for those remedial courses, the old system was not open to it anymore.
GPS STEM representative on the panel, and so we really wanted to emphasize, of course, as part of that project, and as I mentioned, and others mentioned in the panel yesterday, the STEM is a big key successful in that panel, particularly algebra, that's key. So, SIU, you have two pathways, but you started your conversation first on how do I get students through college algebra more effectively, and doing so by not putting on path of long sequences, but really the best thing in the success of that game. Now, in 12 weeks, you have a 12 week course on the basis of
the thing that really deals with it. Because we all have anecdotal evidence that midterm grades are predictive. But it turns out that if you're clean at week 8 of the midterm, 95% of those students succeed in the course. 95% of students are going to be in that particular course. Now, we're always going to lose 2 or 3% to the principal. So, essentially, all of the students who got to clean at week 8 are going to succeed in the course. Now, those are the probabilities there. So 61% of students with yellow at midterm end up succeeding in the course. 39% went down. And again, if we look at the bottom of the red bar, at the very bottom, 91% of the students who were red at midterm ended up either getting a D or W in the course. So earlier, John Morton talked about two things. He talked about real-time data, and he talked about research. So, to do this well on a campus, I think we have to first of all, data analytics. It's all about the data. But the second thing is where do we focus the resources, the limited resources to have to make the campus? So, what we did is say, okay, look, what we're going to do is we're going to take the data, and this semester, fall, football, we're going to look at business and science students. And what we're going to do is we're going to say, let's take the students who are yellow at week 3. And what we're going to do is we're going to include those numbers. We were told the numbers of the yellow students. What do we have to do? What was it? We had a formula strategy that we built. We had a student success course. That's what we call the course, the 12-week course that we offer students to transition from a single year into a continuing course over time. But we also have our college-level retention staff personally approach and contact each student who was yellow at least 3. And give them a personal talk about success, about our sessions, give them a chance to sign up for office hours. There's things that students just simply don't do. I mean, they said they're going to go to office hours, but they're doing that. We have first-year advisors, because they have to come to first-year advisors to actually register the course for the first time. And so, in the course of that, we had a script that our first-year advisors talked them through. We had housing staff involved because students who were not attending college were having a good time. And there's one thing that I thought really made a difference. I went to every single checker in my college life report and I said, look, I want you to know your yellow and red students by name. I just want you to actually personally go up to each one of them, call them by name, and when you're in their employee lobby, I want you to go up and ask them to come to the just know your students. So this is what happened in one semester. This is the thing now, this is this semester's data. What we did is we improved the percentage that went from yellow to green from 33% to 42.5%. We went from yellow to say yellow went from 38% to 42.5%. So in other words, there was a 21.5% increase by just doing a simple intervention strategy. But by using the early warning data to identify the students that needed the extra intervention. And so it was an all-class about resource allocation and using the early warning data to do that. Now, on the basis of this, what we're going to is our central administration and some new more resources for peering into math calculators. So what we're going to do is we're going to have this. In fall 15, we're going to have a regular college algebra class, which is two lectures of 2 hours and 4 weeks there. We're going to have an enhanced college algebra class, which is two lectures and 2 labs, where this is additional co-remediation. So the enhanced college algebra is a co-remediation model, where those are students that would traditionally be in the real mathematics. So now we're going to be in the center college algebra, which is the first 4 years. And now we're going to have to separate that, which is our quantitative reasoning course. For students who come in thinking they want to be electrical engineers, but have trouble with high school mathematics, we're going to put them in our contemporary math course, but give them a remediation coordination model that allows them to complete tests into the same pathway. And so this is going to be, this is about here by 900 students, roughly in that sequence, in the fall semester. those are going to be the three pathways that are going to have some effect. But again, without the data, I couldn't have confused by second assumption that the resources do this useful and look at the effect. So the bottom line is, keep in mind, who are paying CCA strategy, because I tell you. And the whole problem is that our data that we had yesterday showed that if a CCA persists, it's a fact that we're going to do that last course. It allows everybody who really has that as an objective any opportunity to do that data. So everybody who comes in as a strength has an opportunity to take that on the computer model that we're going to do. So that's really amazing. Maybe there's some questions. I'm sorry about that. I don't know if people have particular questions for our panel at this point. Yeah, hit the button and release it. The truth of the matter is that most colleges and universities will only require one course in one for those who are not in the state. So I think there is a fundamental question here that says that when they create a pathway, and that pathway is really a content pathway, which I think the real question is, are we trying to help students to pass the course, or are we preparing the students? Because I think what's the idea of kind of question, whether or not they have the competencies they will need, either in terms of their profession, regardless of that profession, or whether or not they will continue to use that more focused concept to continue to integrate some of the courses, such as psychology and sociology, which will use maybe central tendency type of measures to be able to understand the type of mathematical concepts that have been there in those courses. So I think really there is a very fundamental question is to what extent will a faculty or a group of faculty will decide what the content of that math course will be, aside from making sure that they are able to pass the course to continue.
Thank you.